go ahead and enjoy your meal, and I'm going to introduce our main speaker here today. Just take your time eating. I'd like to welcome and thank you for joining us today. My name is Dr. Mark Browning, and I'm honored to take part in such a unique and special project that will better the lives of children in this community. I also have the honor of introducing to you a lady named Lucy Jane Miller, who will be sharing some interesting information with us about sensory processing disorder, how sensory playgrounds play a part in therapy and treatment. But a little, couple other things before we get to her introduction. Her introduction could be 10 pages long, but we're going to keep it short. But this playground is a tribute to Pat Browning Stone. That's my aunt, and she grew up within 2 miles of here. About 17 years, she was about a half a mile from here, another 17 mile from here, and about 21, about 2 miles from here. And we're about the ISA Center where she grew up and lived most of her life. We lost her at a very young age, at age 59 or so, and she raised these 9 kids. We have 4 of the 9 here today. But as you think of all of you've raised kids, and when you raise kids, you know, there's lots of things you have to learn on your own. And Pat was able to compensate, learn on her own. She didn't have the tools that we're going to create here for other people, the tools that this building is going to do, and what's going to go inside that building is going to help others down the road. And Pat didn't have all that. My mother didn't have that, and many of you didn't have that. But we're going to help other people get some tools to help other, help themselves, help their families, and make a better life for Evansville, a better life for other places. So we're fortunate that Mary and Bill helped fund this. And just quickly about Mary, about Bill and Mary. Mary is a O'Daniel, and we have some people here from USI, and the O'Daniels are instrumental. They say Mary McDonald helped start USI, but it's over 50 years ago, and the O'Daniel family is very instrumental in having our University of Southern Indiana here. So Bill and Mary have helped the University of Southern Indiana, they've helped the University of Evansville, they've helped also Memorial High School. So they've been part of what we call an educational system. They've also been part of a business system. They've helped set SS&C up here. He could have put that in many other places in the United States, but he picked a hometown. We're lucky to have over 210 employees making paychecks and keeping the brain drain from happening in Evansville. So keeping these young brains and smart kids here, and we need more of that. We need more businesses like that. And now he's jumped into a third thing. He's jumped into the healthcare system. So he sees the need, and we're just lucky he sees the need. And Mary has been very agreeable to make all this happen. So this is just a fabulous thing. And he says we have to measure things, as he said earlier. We're going to measure things. A young lady, Jessica Wood, gave a talk already on Friday. There were 30 people, 30 of us there listening to how to measure things, how to do things, and Jessica's gonna go do an internship for about 4 weeks next year with Lucy Miller. So we're going to measure. I don't think we'll measure as well as SS&C measures things, but we are gonna have some measures. And we're not gonna waste Mary and Bill Stone's money. It's gonna be used well. And we're gonna make that happen. We have a young lady in this front circle table here next to Lucy, and her name is Dr. Maria Del Rio. And I think, sometimes I think my thyroid level's a little high, but I think hers is higher than mine. And she's gonna be very instrumental in making this happen. And I don't think she sleeps very much. So Bill and Mary, don't you worry about this thing getting done the right way. Now, as we studied this and tried to get this process going, I've never heard of a sensory playground 8 months ago, and this was Bill's idea, Mary's idea. It wasn't anything to do with So I've been studying for 8 months, and so now we've learned a lot about sensory playgrounds. We've had to try to keep this non-public till about a month ago, so we've been lots of meetings and lots of understanding. And we found some individual out in Denver that was probably the world, one of the world's experts. And I thought, I'll just say a few things about her before she gets up here and talks, because we will use her many, many times during the next many years for her advice and making sure this process goes the right way. She's been only working on it for 30 plus years, and she was only trained by Dr. Ayers, who was the expert before her for 30 years. So we've got about 60 years of experience going in here. So a gentleman named Martin Luther King said, he says, very important, take the first step up the ladder. Well, we've already taken 3 steps up this ladder, and sometimes you don't know where you're going, but we know more and more where we're going as we're working on this. So last comment about the Stones before we get to her introduction is, there's a famous book by a person named Thomas Wolfe. He's in Asheville, North Carolina. He says, you can't go home again. Well, I think Bill and Mary have rebutted that book. You can't go home again. The book talks about nostalgia. When one goes back to their hometown, everything changes. They don't realize they've changed, but also the town changes. Well, Mary and Bill are making some changes for us for the betterment. So we as a community are very fortunate to have this donation, and it's not going to be wasted. So Dr. Miller, I may introduce her. This is my only job was today to do that, so that was a little excerpt there. She's the founder of the STAR Institute for Sensory Processing Disorder. It's the actually first comprehensive sensory processing disorder research program in the United States. We've been blessed to work with her on Patricia Browning Stone Playground, and we've employed her expertise in choosing every structure in the playground. She's been investigating, analyzing, explaining sensory processing disorders to other scientists, professionals, and parents since she studied under this pioneer named Jean Ayers more than 30 years ago. Since then, Dr. Miller and her colleagues have been helping to bring SPD, sensory processing disorder, widespread recognition, and our work with families has improved lives across our country. She's an author of more than 60 articles and chapters in peer-reviewed journals, and she's received more than 30 funded awards and grants, and she's received the highest award possible in the United States in her specialty for occupational therapy. So we're happy to have her talk today. Lucy Miller.
I was at the Children's Hospital of Denver and on the University medical school staff for 12 years, but I had to leave there because they didn't want me to work with children. They only wanted me to teach other people. They thought it would be a conflict if I worked with children because I would take away from children. So I thought it would add to children, but they didn't look at it that way. So I left and started the Star Institute. It was really a good thing I did because now we're seeing 700 families a year. We have a full-time program of research and we have a very exhaustive program of education as well. So why have a playground? The thing is, playgrounds are where kids are most comfortable. And not only kids, but parents. You know, you're inside four white walls in a clinical situation and people feel like something's wrong with them. You're outdoors on a playground and people feel familiar with it. And they don't feel that things are wrong. Also, the staff feel better interacting in the natural environment. I mean, all of us were kids and we remember being on playground and it was fun. So it sets you up for success. Why is all this important? It's important because the most single powerful change agent that predicts a child's success is family connections. And I have picked up in Evansville this family connection energy, which is amazing. You know, I live in Denver, which is a city of 3.5 million people. We don't have anywhere near the support that you have here for the sensory playground. It's because it's small enough to be family driven, and the energy is so positive here. Our program in Denver focuses on joie de vivre, which means joy in life, as the most important treatment objective. While developmental growth is very important, nothing is as important as joy and success. Compare a playground environment to a standard treatment room, and there's no comparison when you're outside. Not only environmentally are you outside the block, but also in terms of the treatment process. But we have a phrase called care. We care about the children. Care stands for connection, attunement, relationship, and enjoyment. And I heard that word care today in your groundbreaking. We haven't cut the ribbon yet. We've only cut the cord, the umbilical cord. We started the process, and I heard the word care come up over and over again today, and that's the same word that we use. So how do you get to care with your child? The key to care for the child is twofold. First of all, understanding that the child needs to play to develop. Play is the child's work. Knowing that the family needs to be involved in the care. It's never just a child's problem. Never, not ever. It's not that you need to take the child away and fix the child. It's about the connection between the parent and the child. Always. So connecting families and kids, attuning to what the child needs, building relationships, and adding a lasting agreement, which is joy for us and being. So we have I've cut down our videotapes from like 15 minutes to about 1 minute, and I have a few to share with you. This is a videotape about parents talking about what the playground does for them.
The playground is one of the places from the very beginning that we could go out as a family and we could feel normal. So many wonderful things have happened on a playground that I never imagined would happen. Well, I'm on the playground with my kids. It's not just a break time for me. It's a time to really, again, be able to connect with my kids through play. What I didn't know is that the playground would develop increasing a friendship with me as his mom. This place, what happened to here is that magic happens. Magic happens between he and I can see it in his eyes, and it also happens for me. It takes me as an adult back to a place where I should be.
So on playgrounds, there's a lot of things that touch my heart because my son doesn't fit into a lot of typical situations very easily. He's has some social issues. He doesn't talk. So able to be strong because he is strong, but to explore and engage on playground equipment helps him just fit in with his peers.
I remember one time he actually offered a hand on this slide right back here to help another boy out, which was the first time I think he acknowledged a peer, and they were together in something. And one of the little boys
quietly, and we both turned around and he said goodbye, and that's the first time that I ever saw anybody ever acknowledge Riley or be happy to see Riley.
It's just plain fun. It really is just plain fun.
They've lasted almost 10 years on our playground. They'll last on your playground, and you can build onto it if you want. You don't have to. You have many pieces that will last forever. The parents can go over the slides just like the kids do. They can come down the slides. They can go on the merry-go-round. It's all made for adults and children to be together. So we have this thing that we describe that happens, which we call it. It happens. It is when you connect with your child. It is when the child has such joy and such laughter and advances because he's happy and successful. What do we need for it to happen? Well, we need specially trained and well-trained therapists. We need a sensory-friendly environment because sensation is the first thing to come into your brain. We need sunshine, or at least not pouring rain, or what we have here, an indoor-outdoor playground, which is perfect. So it doesn't matter what the weather is. We're just lucky that it's that way. Colorado is kind of unusual because we have so much sunshine. But an indoor-outdoor playground like we've designed here is perfect for this environment. The playground makes it happen faster, deeper, and long-lasting. And we call those magic moments when we can connect the kids with their parents. But first, there must be a solid evidence base, which Mr. Stone was talking about this morning. So for 22 years, the Wallace Research Foundation has been funding scientists to study sensory processing disorders. They found me first in 1995, and they have a mission to go out and find people who are trying to do research and fund them for 3 years. So they have to show you real quick what they funded us to do. Funded us for 3 years. At the end of that 3 years, they said, boy, you've made so much progress. Who do you want to fund next? And for 22 years, I've been going around the country finding all these NIH-funded scientists who have now joined the scientific work group and have all participated in studying sensory processing disorder. So today, more than 50 researchers, most at top institutes like Harvard, Yale, Duke, University of California, San Francisco, University of Wisconsin, and Madison, and a lot more are funded by the Wallace Research Foundation and became collaborators in the scientific work group. The findings support the concepts and complexities of the mechanisms of the disorder, the etiology of the disorder, the pathology, and the treatment of sensory processing disorder. So you might have heard of Henry Wallace. He used to be vice president, one of the Henry Wallaces. I used to say I have Henry VIII, but really he's only the fifth. Four generations of Henry Wallaces who have supported America to do research and to try to understand various different kinds of things. So the process, the Research Wallace Foundation was funded from 1995 to 2017. This was our last year of funding for our group, but we had a conference celebrating everything we had found, and Dr. Maria Delvio, was at our conference, so she got to hear all the newest research that we have. So let me just give you a peek into our research, a little tiny peek. We wanted to know, are kids with sensory processing just different from kids who are typically developing, and how are they different? So we designed this spaceship. The children come in, and they're little astronauts, and they watch Apollo 13 movie. Oh. No, back up. One more try, and then we'll skip it. During the... Then they get strobe light for visual. And they get each one of these stimuli 10 times in a row. They get a siren for auditory. They get peppermint for olfactory, that means smell. They get a little feather for tactile touch. And the chairs hook the computer, it automatically tips back 15 degrees. That measures the vestibular or movement system. And then there's a recovery period of about 3 minutes. And just to show you what the data look like, and you will understand this, it's totally understandable, because each one of these parallel vertical lines is a sensory stimuli. The first smell, the second smell, the third smell, they're all the same. And your brain is that little jubilee line in the center. And your brain goes, ooh, I smell something different. I better be prepared to run and hide or run and fight because it might be dangerous. So you get the second smell, and it's the same as the first smell, and your brain calms down. The third and fourth, just tiny little responses, and then you habituate, so you don't even smell it anymore. That's what we all do, hopefully most of us. A child with sensory processing disorder has much bigger responses. The amplitude is higher, more frequent responses. Sometimes there's two responses to one stimulus, and there's no habituation. So this tells us, because what this is a measure of is a sympathetic nervous system. So it tells us that children with SPD have different sympathetic responsivity to sensation. So this was the first article in a medical journal about kids with SPD. We have now done, 22 years of research, and one of the most recent researchers is looking at fMRIs and found that there's an abnormality in white matter in the posterior tract that's in the back of your brain. So that's where sensation is integrated, as opposed to the frontal part of your brain, which is what where problems are with autism and ADHD. And the third mechanism is multisensory integration. Multisensory integration is when everything gets integrated on a single neuron. So let's say you're reading a book. What are some of the sensations that you experience reading the book? You see it, you touch it, you might hear it, and you change the page, you feel it, okay? Which one of those happens first? The thing is, those all happen at the same time. And the reason they happen at the same time is multisensory integration. Everything converges on a single neuron, and that neuron interprets the information. So the picture on the left is a normal person, that's a normal EEG, where that dotted line is, I don't know if you can see my cursor, but where the dotted line is, right there, is where the stimuli is administered. And if it's red, it's auditory. If the response is black, it's tactile. And if it's green, it's both together. So they either get a click, they get a stimulus to their wrist, or they get both together. And which has the biggest response? Both together, the green ones. So this is a typical child. This is a child with sensory processing disorder. Very disorganized, no real pattern, not normal. This is published in the Neurological Journal. So multisensory integration is off. There are three of the first mechanisms that we found. We also looked at prevalence, and we studied kids prospectively. That means they haven't had any intervention. We got the NIH grant. By we, I mean the members of the scientific work group, not me personally. But we always talk about we because we're such a strong research group. So Alice Carter from Yale measured children for over a 10-year period, all the children who were born in New Haven. And and she found that 16% by the time they were 10 had symptoms of sensory processing disorder. So that's the prevalence we use. And a very interesting thing that Alice Carter found was that families living with a child with SPD have greater family impairment than those living with children with psychological disorders like autism or bipolar. The reason is they get no support. Nobody believes you if you have a child with SPD because it's not in the diagnostic and statistical manual, which is the Bible for doctors use to diagnose. So those families living with SPD don't have the support that they need to feel successful. We also have a program for adults.
As an adult living with what I now know is sensory processing disorder, I have felt a crushing loneliness my entire life. There were bright lights, loud sounds, not understanding what was happening to my body, and feeling like there was something terribly wrong with me, and feeling like I was flawed. Depression, obesity, anxiety, migraine, vertigo, any number of things that were basically, I'm learning, are the symptoms of the underlying cause of sensory processing disorder. I've seen such important, big, significant gains in a short time. And the investment has already paid off. Working with the STAR Institute has been one of the best investments I've ever made in my entire life.
So how do we treat SPD? And what's so unique about our treatment approach? First, it's not about how many words can a child say. It's not about how many blocks can a child stack. It's about how strong their ability to relate is, how strong their family relationships are, how strong their self-regulation is, and how we create a sensory lifestyle, not a sensory diet. This is a great, very short little clip of a child who came to us, he's not yet two, 1.5 years old. And when he first came, he was unable to relate to anybody. Okay, so he comes to us. This is him. This is his therapist. And this is his mother over here. On here. Right. Every time he gets close to his mother, look how he turns his face away from her. He cannot relate to his mother. He cannot relate to his therapist. And I slowed it down so you could see what I was talking about. He's always turning away from his mother. Look how sad the mother looks. So we put him in this type of treatment, which is very relationship-based.
Really slow, he's looking. He's trying to draw back too now.
So we have two therapists, one's coaching the other.
Even slower, you've got him slow. And now, yes.
And he doesn't even look like the same child. That's his mom.
Yeah.
And we caught the first glimpse this child ever shared with his mother. We also have more technical randomized controlled studies of the effectiveness of OT in children with sensory modulation disorder. And we are constantly doing studies to study treatment effectiveness. But one of the best ways to know about treatment effectiveness is listen to the parents.
It felt impossible because I didn't know what to do. I was utterly exhausted. I was blaming myself. I was feeling like a terrible mother. Even at just young, 2 years old, Elijah had a really hard time. He didn't play like other children play. He didn't connect like other children connect. I didn't have a connection or a relationship with him. He was very distant. He didn't show really much affection and love for other people. Every one of my instincts or ideas of what might be wrong with him was being dismissed. I knew the minute I came in that our journey was about to begin. There was something about this place. It was so deep in
connecting with the staff here, I knew from them about the kinds of services and what was going to be provided here and how the model was very different than anything else I'd ever heard of or seen. But I knew right away that things here, doing it at the Star Institute, were going to be very different. And the way that the staff interact with us, they don't just interact with him, they don't treat him, they work with us together. The parent education sessions that I attended here at the Star Institute focused so much just on him. When I'm playing with Elijah in that treatment model, the parent education is providing for me the rationale and the reason as to why. So the minute we leave these doors, I can go home and do the exact same thing. And I know why I'm doing what I'm doing. Elijah and I now have a relationship. We have, I mean, that's something that you could never even dream of in the beginning. Now when he approaches me or comes and strokes my face, or we'll lay in bed, we'll have what's called special time, and he'll come and ask me to do something just one-on-one with him, or he'll look into my eyes and say, "Mommy, I love you." I never imagined that we would be able to interact in that way.
So the most exciting finding of scientific work group was that treatment really works, makes a difference, and the ability to show that children and family get better on their own prioritized goals using this approach. The process of treatment was started by bundling existing interventions such as sensory integration and DIR at the Star Institute. It's the only place that I know of that does this treatment other than the places of people who've trained about 600 people worldwide in this approach. And we treat through a mentorship program. So like our treatment is intensive, our education is intensive. People come to us for a week at a time, or sometimes we go to them. We just started on-site mentorship also. Mentorship 1 is advanced overview. Mentorship 2 is hands-on intensive treatment where they treat one client every day for a week. Mentorship 3 is a research mentorship where we're training people to do multiple baseline studies so we can publish a book on the effectiveness of the treatment. We also have a mental health mentorship for psychologists and social workers and psychiatric nurses and so on. And we've just started certification programs with Temple University. So this is a pre-post study, which is one of the studies that came out of this mentorship. And I know you're going to be interested in who can be trained to do the treatment. It takes a lot to be trained. It's not a one-hour lecture and you get trained. That's why we have to do the mentorship. You can be taught to do it. It depends on the level of the people you're training, the number of trainees to faculty. We have about 10 faculty that are trained now in new workshops nationwide. The depth to which you want people trained, you want somebody just to know a little bit, or do you want somebody to really be able to do it? Here's a quote from Minerva, who lives in Mexico City. "Training at the Star Institute has profoundly changed me and my practice approach." The scientific work group has discovered so much more, but we don't have time to go into it. There are over 100 reprints that have been published in the last 10 years, and we're searching for a way to continue the group's research. And here's just a few of the articles that have been published. One is with primates and pharmacology. These two are reaction and borderline personality disorders as adults, and cluster analysis validating subtypes of SPD. I don't expect you to read these. I just wanted to put them up here for a second so you could get a glimpse at the kinds of research that have been published by the scientific work group. Here's the last videotape. This is related to the research that we do on the playground.
One of the things that's really exciting is that we're doing some fantastic evidence-based research on the playground. In one of our projects, we use the playground as a probe in a multiple baseline design. The probe is where you test certain things over time to see if they get better. So we're looking, for example, at the interaction of the children with each other. We see these kids playing with each other and the ways that we can measure their interactions with each other, their interactions with their parents, and we can tell if the therapy is working, because if the therapy is working, the interactions with each other should get better and more rich and deep over time. We have a camera which is attached here, which we can run from inside, which is a pan, zoom, tilt, camera. What the camera does is allows us to do close-ups of the kids or do the whole yard and get as much rich data as we can from our research project.
Yes, it's about the playground, but also using STARS framework, you can focus on the process. It's not a procedure, it's not like a shot, it's not like a pill, it's not a curriculum, it's not a protocol, it's a philosophy and an approach that honors the person inside the child and the parent. And I heard a lot about family-centered care this morning when people were talking, and brought warmth to my heart because I know that you want what I want, which is an opportunity to impact the clinicians, to impact the families on playgrounds, like the Patricia Browning Stone playground in Evansville, change lives, children's lives, parents' lives, bring families together. And last slide.
It's in there.
Thank you.